ollaan saavuttu Dubliniin, Irlantiin. International Poker Open, ihan mieletön meininki, koska pandemian jälkeen vihdoinkin live poker is back. Danny on takas pöydissä. Täällä on tuhansia pelaajia täällä eventeissä. Ollaan lähdössä metsästämään pyttyä. Ja ehkä just miksi mä oon rakastunut pokeriin vielä entistä enemmän on just nää live-reissut. Tää on mahtavaa. Tälkeen mä en oo ikinä aikaisemmin ollut tässä maassa. Pääsen näkemään uusia paikkoja, tapaamaan uusia ihmisiä. Nää on ihan mahtavia kokemuksia niin joka kerta kun näille reissuille pääsee. Ja ei muuta, lähdetään pöytiin tsekkaan, että mikä meininki. Irlanti on mahtava pokerimatkakohde, koska siis tää jengi, nää on ihan hulluna pokeria. Täällä on pelattu 70-luvun loput lähtien ja tää pelataan myös maailman toiseksi vanhin turnaus edelleen VSOP:n jälkeen. Oikeesti tuolla pöydissä näkee se huokuu, miten paljon nää dikkaa tästä pelistä. Ja hei, nyt lähdetään tapaamaan yhtä Irlannin menestyneimmistä pokerin pelaajista ja myös pokerin kirjailijana tunnettua Dara O'Kearneyn.
When I was growing up, the most popular game was whist, which is a form of bridge, but is also a very social game. And I think poker sort of replaced whist because it added this gambling element and drinking element as well, which Irish people enjoy. The Irish Open is the second oldest tournament in the world, I believe the oldest in Europe. So the Irish have been playing poker for money in fairly big tournaments since the early 80s. And it's always been very, very popular here, particularly live poker. So I've been doing competitive stuff all my life. When I was a teenager, I was playing chess at a fairly high level. Once I realized I was never going to be a chess grandmaster, I stopped playing chess and I played bridge at a very high level. And then in my mid-20s, I got into running and that continued for about 15 years. I ended up international ultra runner representing Ireland. For people who don't know what ultra running is, that's basically any race longer than a marathon. So I ran every distance from 50 kilometers up to 24-hour races. I did that for a few years and I realized that I was getting older and I wasn't going to be competitive at running for much longer. So I was kind of looking around for something else that I could do where maybe my age wouldn't be a factor. I actually saw the Irish Poker Open on TV late one night, and I just saw that there were, you know, older people playing and age didn't seem to be a big issue there. So I thought, okay, well, maybe I could play poker. I started poker at the age of 42. I was middle-aged. I was at an age where most people are sort of focused completely on some boring job. I had a particularly boring job at the time and I was actually looking to get out into something else. For the first few months, I played online. I just played online, but I did very well from the start. I got kind of obsessed with the game, not just playing it, but thinking about it, just studying the strategy and all that stuff. So within a few months, I was making more money from online poker than I was from my job. So I thought, okay, well, I'll just do this full time. I've always really enjoyed strategy games. That's since I was a child, that was the thing I enjoyed the most. So to find a strategy game that I could actually play full time and justify playing full time because I could make enough money from it to support my family, that was just amazing to me. The fact that it was poker, which is actually my favorite game of all the games that I've played, once I got into it because the strategy is so complex, that was literally like a new life for me. My old life, I was doing the work that I had to do to support my family, not particularly enjoying the work. And suddenly I had this thing which I really enjoyed and I got to make money from, and I got to travel the world and meet lots of interesting people. I've made lots of friends from poker over the years, and to the point that most of my friends now are poker friends. And the thing I like most about it is just, it's so diverse. I know people from 20 different countries. I know people of all ages. When my son came with me to the World Series, he was shocked that guys younger than him were hanging around with me, and we were essentially friends rather than just an older guy with younger guys. That's what I like about poker. It breaks down all those barriers. The closest friend I guess I've made is David Lappin, who I do the Chip Race podcast with. David moved back from Ireland about 10 years ago, and he didn't really know anybody in the Irish poker scene because he lived in America for a few years. Dave is quite an eccentric and entertaining person, and he didn't really make very many friends and made many, many enemies in Irish poker very quickly. So I kind of thought, well, somebody needs to take this guy under his wing. So he needs to have at least one friend, basically. So I started hanging around with him, and people were saying, like, why are you hanging around with this guy? He's a total dick. But he's actually very, very entertaining. And when you get to know him, he's a very loyal friend, and he's a very funny guy. He's also very, very focused on what we've been doing together with the chip race. And one story I remember about David, this is kind of like just how focused he is. A few years ago, we went over to play Party Millions event in Rosvodov. And there was a group of four of us at the tournament. And we all bust before dinner break. So we're in Rosvodov and we've nothing to do. And we're like, Rosvodov is not a great place to have to spend a weekend. So we decided we'll go to Prague. So we went back to Prague. We booked into a hotel. That night we were interviewing Griffin Benger for our podcast, The Chip Race. David was focused on, we want the internet to be really good. We don't want the internet to cut out while we're interviewing Griffin. So as we're checking into the hotel, and I'm giving them the names, there's a sign on the side saying there's a honeymoon suite and list of all the things in the honeymoon suite. And down at the bottom, there's enhanced Wi-Fi. And that's the only thing David is focused on, enhanced Wi-Fi. This is what we'll be. So as we're booking in, he says to the receptionist, how much would it cost us to upgrade to the honeymoon suite? And she's looking at us going like, why do these two guys want the honeymoon suite? What's happening here? He gives her no explanation. No explanation whatsoever. He says, yeah, we want the honeymoon suite. So she tells him how much it's going to be. And he says, okay, yeah, we'll take it. And then he says, and you're sure the Wi-Fi is really good? And she's like, yeah, the Wi-Fi is good. And he said, that's good because we have lots of recording to do. Again, no explanation. It's like, so now she's like, okay, what is going on here? But anyway, okay, fine, you're upgraded. Now there's your keys. Now leave, you two very strange people. So we get into the lift, we go up. We have a couple of hours before the interview. We check all the Wi-Fi, it's all good. David has a newborn son at the time and he's living in Malta, and he says that baby formula is really expensive there and it's apparently much cheaper in Prague. So he says he wants to go to the supermarket and buy as much baby formula as we can carry back to the hotel. So I go with him and he says, how much baby formula can you carry? So I'm like carrying this amount, just you can barely see my face. So we walk back into the hotel. We also don't take a bag because bags cost extra money and David doesn't want to pay money. So we're literally just carrying boxes and boxes of baby formula. And I look over at the receptionist and she's staring at us going, what are those two guys doing? What are they doing? And David has no conception of how this looks from the outside, but I obviously do, but he, you know, no explanation. And that's one of the reasons why I like hanging out with David. He's just always so entertaining, but he's in his own world. I started playing live in 2008, I think. The first big tournament I entered was the European Deep Stack, which I actually ended up winning. And I thought live poker was really easy. You just show up and you win tournaments. I was full time at that stage, but I quickly found out that it wasn't actually that easy. But in terms of if you're playing a tournament and you know you're not too experienced and you're wondering how to play live or what sort of tips I could give. There's a couple of things I would say. First of all, live poker plays quite differently from online poker, but there's more information. You can see all of your opponents and different people play very differently from each other. And the most important thing is to pay attention to everybody and see the way that they're playing and try and figure out how they're playing. The other thing I would say is that you can't win a tournament at the start. You can't win the tournament on day one. You have to get through the entire tournament. Try to play cautiously in the sense of when you have, you know, a small hand, not very good hand, keep the pot small. There's no need to force the pace in live tournaments. Most of the opponents are very bad at poker. They will give you lots of opportunities to get their chips. That's the most important thing. The other thing I would say is you are never going to go through the tournament where everything just goes brilliantly. You're always going to have big setbacks. You're always going to get unlucky in pots. And you have to be able to just do a mental reset and go, that didn't happen. Or, well, that did happen, but I'm not going to let it affect me next hand. Just get into this thing of next hand, next hand, next hand. It's a mental reset at the start of every hand.
Yeah, Yes, yes. No niin, muutama tunti pelattu main eventtiä. On tosi, tosi suosittua, että täällä on monta, monta alkuerää pelaajia. Mä veikkaan, että tulee yhteensä yli 1000. Ja tota, siitä tosiaan sitten osa kaksi joutuu kakkospäivällä ja sitten on finaali vielä kolmospäivänä. Et jännä nähdä, miten menee. Itse ihan hyvissä on enemmän stackia kuin keskiarvostäkki. Eli so far so good, mutta pitkä matka vielä. Että tota, nyt on breikki, otetaan vähän happea. Tota, pieni lepo tässä. Sitten jatketaan.
People sometimes ask if there's any similarities between what I did before the ultra running and poker, and actually I think there are a lot of similarities, and so, some are somewhat obvious and some are not quite so obvious. I think the obvious one is that stamina is obviously a benefit even in poker, and that might seem a little bit strange given that you're just sitting at a table. But if you have to play a long day, 12 hours or a long online session, 12 to 16 hours, stamina is super important, just being able to keep your brain functioning at a high level. I found when I came into poker that I had a natural advantage in that area from the running. I found towards the end of days, towards the end of long days, particularly live, when everybody else was getting tired, I wasn't tired, I was completely alert. And that's where I felt I had the biggest advantage over most people. Another thing I think which helps is when you're running, you're basically doing the same thing over and over again, one foot in front of the other. And you have to be able to just stay in the moment and not think about, this is a 24-hour race and it started an hour ago, I have to keep going for 23 hours. That can mess with your head. Same in poker, you just have to stay calm. No matter what happens, you stay in the moment and you deal with whatever happens in the moment and you try and be as detached as possible from anything bad which can happen. And I think that's another advantage. The third one I think is, it's not particularly exciting to run a 24-hour race. You're running very slow and usually the race is just around a circuit. So it's like 200 laps of something. So it's not particularly exciting, but and you have to be able to be okay with that. Be okay with the fact that it's not thrilling. And while live poker has these great moments of excitement, most of it is very boring. You're just sitting there, you're dealt cards, you can't play these cards, you have to fold those cards, and you have to be able to do that without getting bored and doing stuff just because you're bored. You have to be okay with the fact that you are literally just playing a long game, essentially.
Yhdeksän ja puoli tuntia peliä takana, vitsi, että on väsynyt, mutta onnellinen fiilis, koska 386 pelaajaa aloitti ja 63 meni jatkoon, meitsi yksi niistä. Kasino oli todella kova hulabaloo, mutta itse olen ottanut untapalloa ja koetaan tällään olla freshinä huomenna päivä kakkoselle. Meillä oli hullu setti, painettiin main eventin day 1:stä. About 10 tunnin pelit. 970 pelaajasta total. Noin 170 on selvinnyt jatkoon. Meitsi mukana yksi niistä. Superhyvä fiilis. Antoni yksi sen opein, niin otin tähän day 2 freshin starti. Vähän ulkoilua, hyvän preku. Mä oon valmis.
Almost anybody can become a winning player. I know lots of winning players. They come from all sorts of different backgrounds. Different levels of intelligence, different education levels, etc. There seems to be no real requirement other than an ability to apply yourself and really study hard. And that's become more important over the course of my career. When I started, most people got by on natural talent or natural aggression. But now to get to the top, you basically have to put in a lot of work. The best way to think about a poker tournament is not as one continuous thing, but it's something which has very, very different phases. And a day one of a poker tournament is very different from a day two. And day two, again, is different from a day three. What makes it different is at the start of the tournament, everybody has very deep stacks. And you know, you get to play a lot of pots. You're not going to be at risk unless it's very big hand against very big hand, or you lose your mind and you try to bluff somebody off a very big hand. So it's mostly just a battle of, it's a war of small battles where you're trading chips gradually, and it plays almost like a cash game where you're just trying to make the right decisions to win the maximum amount of chips in every pot that you play. It's quite a slow process. By the time you get to day two, the stacks are now a lot shallower, and it's much more likely that even if you have a big stack, you'll be playing against other shorter stacks, and they're going to be all in before the end of the hand. And the game now changes. It changes essentially to a preflop game. You have to understand that. You can't go on playing the same way that you did. You also have to understand that you will be forced to get all in more often. You can't just fold because you don't want to put too much chips in. So you kind of have to accept that it's going to be gamble. And you have to accept that sometimes that won't work, and you know, you'll have setbacks. So you have to prepare yourself mentally for what if something goes wrong and you know somebody sucks out on me. You need to understand the situations in which it's correct for you to get all in, not be afraid to get all in, and accept the outcome of whatever happens. Even if the other guy makes a mistake and you end up losing the hand, that is poker, that is part of poker. You have to be able to handle that. Sometimes when my students make big online final tables, we do a preparatory session. And what I always focus on is getting them to imagine everything that could possibly go wrong. I get sucked out on hand one. This happens, that happens. And the reason for that is, if you go in with too much, in my opinion again, of a positive mindset, everything's going to be great and I'm just going to win the tournament, then as soon as something bad happens, there's a danger that'll affect your performance. So you have to prepare yourself mentally for the bad stuff that can happen, so that if it does happen, and hopefully it won't, but if it does happen, at least you've sort of rehearsed your response to that. The money bubble is obviously the most dramatic part of the tournament, because you have whatever number of players are going to be paid, not much more than that left in the tournament. And once the money bubble bursts, it's going to be 200 very happy people in the room and one very unhappy person walking away. You have to kind of understand that this is a completely unique part of the tournament. The strategy is very different. There are spots where you might have to fold kings, even if you think the guy is shoving any two cards. There are spots, but then conversely, when you have the big stack, there are spots where you should be opening any two cards because everybody behind you is folding. They're trying to get into the money. So the game changes. It's no longer really about the cards you have. It's about what the stacks at the table are, what the players at the table are doing as a result of those stacks, and the fact that there's this big money bubble looming.
In the main event, you are all now in the money.
Such a complex game. You can learn it very quickly, you can get quite good at it very quickly, because on one level it's fairly simple, but the high level strategy is just incredibly complicated, and you could devote 1,000 lifetimes to it. The most important thing to succeed at live tournaments in the long term, in my opinion, is discipline. In the short term, luck determines everything and it overrides everything. And because luck determines in the short term who's going to win a tournament, people over-focus on luck and they think, well, that's all that matters. But if you look at the people who are successful long-term and who do well in tournaments long-term, there are people who are very disciplined. And that applies to both how you play. You have to be stay disciplined. You have to not get tilted or annoyed or frustrated when the tournament isn't going your way. But it also applies to away from the table. You know, have good study habits, have good lifestyle habits in general. All this stuff, because poker is a game where you get constantly disappointed, particularly in tournaments. The typical tournament experience is you play the tournament, you think it might be going great for a while, and then it's over and you're disappointed. Everybody leaves the tournament disappointed except the guy who won. Even the guy who comes second is disappointed because he didn't win. So you have to be able to handle this constant negative feedback of disappointment and just stay disciplined and focus on the long term.
Main event on omalta osalta ohi, oli aika tunteiden vuoristorata. Eli mitä oli vajaa 1000 pelaajaa, pääsin siellä 118, pääsin rahoille just 119 sai sitä hyvää. Ja eka tosiaan venattiin, että kupla puhkesi, sit se, eli venattiin, että ihmiset pääsee rahoille, sitten se tapahtui ja kaikki taputti ja bileet, mutta sitten seuraavaan käteen mentiin mun kutospari vastaan. Akka kymppi vastaan, S-jätkä ja valitettavasti kutoset ei pitänyt ja Danny on out, mutta...
Sellaista tää turnauspokeri on. Vaikka just nyt vähän harmittaakin. Tästä tuli taas tärkeitä kokemusta ja ensi kerralla mennään sitten taas päätyyn asti.